Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Fairy Queen's Daughter by Melissa Marr, narrated by Kristin James. Prologue, In Which Paths Cross. Ivy watched Jonquil's face as the little Ellil peered out from the foliage around them, the tiny fairy's multi-toned skin like a strange blossom in the dark. Made it impossible to truly hide herself above ground. Most fae were afraid, terrified of the shadows that crept and sent secrets back to the palace. Everything had become so incredibly wrong, but if a fairy the size of Ivy's hand could risk everything, the Mad Queen's daughter could do no less. Ivy stepped closer to the tree and asked, "Do you think the queen is getting any better?" Jonquil stepped off the edge of the branch, hovering in a sliver of moonlight, wings glimmering and peering into one of Ivy's eyes.
Do you?
I don't know. If she is, why does the queen refuse to talk to me? Ivy stopped, her words barely audible under the belling of the hounds. They echoed through the night, terrible, long, low calls coming closer. The sound was only a moment's warning before the terror followed. Jonquil paled.
Run,
Ivy said. The tiny fairy's feet touched down on the mossy soil at the base of a nearby tree. Her hand pushed on the knotty wood where a wee door was hidden before darting through a miniature door to the fairy realm, leaving Ivy alone in the face of the oncoming horror of the huntsmen and their beasts. Ivy's feet barely touched the soil as she leapt over branch and bramble. The earth shook as the huntsmen's horses came into range. Like a nightmare come to life, the skeletal steeds trampled everything in their path. At this distance, only the eerie green glow of their eyes and the sulfurous clouds of their breath were clear. Even that scant look was enough. Terror surged into the very air around her. Ivy scrambled into a tree.
I shall not fear them. I cannot. Do not fear. I am not the quarry.
She bit down on her lip to keep from whimpering. Her knuckles whitened as she clenched a limb. A crashing rose from the ground, too frantic to be the hounds. Ivy glanced down, hoping that whatever it was hadn't led the hunt to her hiding spot. A mortal man and woman ran into sight, the woman's skirt in tatters, the man's cheek bleeding. The man watched over his shoulder while the woman hoisted a bundle midway up the tree into a hollow, frantically packing leaves and soil in after it.
"Hurry,"
the man whispered. He tugged the woman's hand so hard she stumbled. And they were off. Their feet stirred clouds of dust as they ran down the path leading to the nearby mortal village. Without the shadows and scents of the forest to mask their humanness, they had little chance of escaping the hunt.
What fool reason would send them into the open like that?
Ivy shook her head. Mortals seldom made sense. The hunt came into view. The hounds were like a black wave under the horse's hooves. Sparks of red flashed in that rolling darkness as the hounds' eyes became visible. Above that awful vision were the huntsmen themselves, some bare-chested, some armored. They were a strange mix of folk and mortal, plucked from their rightful times to join the hunt. Sometimes their armor revealed their era. Often, though, trying to focus on any one when they were in motion was like watching a tongue of flame in a roaring fire. Each one was too quickly lost in the mass that surrounded it. Had things become so bad that the queen would let loose the hunt above ground without sending warning?
They were hers to command, a fierce weapon, but not one released lightly. Then, as swiftly as they'd approached, the huntsmen shifted course, their thundering hooves veering away from the copse of trees where she hid, following the path the mortals had taken. Still trembling, Ivy dropped to the forest floor. Even though the hunt had raced away, dragging their waves of terror with them, she no longer wanted to be above ground. She could pretend they were no more than nursery boggles, harmless to her now that she was older, but her heart hammered still. The hunt rides. Pretending didn't make the terror abate, didn't make the nightmares any less real. She turned to flee, but then she heard it, an unmistakable cry from the hollow in the tree.
Go, go before they turn back.
She closed her eyes and took a deep breath.
Maybe it's just an animal. Go.
The cry rose louder.
It's not my responsibility.
As daughter to the queen, Ivy had shouldered more than enough responsibility in her 14 years. She didn't need this one, too.
I could still run.
With shaking hands, Ivy removed the handful of twigs and moss the woman had packed in.
Why are they after this?
Ivy lifted the dirty length of cloth and the mortal babe it was wrapped around. If the queen sent the hounds after him, he mattered to Ivy. The queen of faery might be mad, but she didn't bother with mortals. Not unless they were special. Chapter 1, in which Jack Mary discovers that all is not as it would seem. Inside the fairy hill, they dance to music that plays endlessly, lilting rhythms like the music of the stars in midsummer. Jack Mary grinned at the townsfolk who had paused in their courtyard to listen to his tale while they took their midday meal. Some of them looked at him, waiting. Even those that didn't look his way were listening. Sometimes, he continued, if you close your eyes at the moment when the sun slides away at night, you can hear their feet as they dance. And for a moment, he imagined that he could hear it, the tramp of dozens of feet moving in time to strange songs. Such music couldn't be made by the crude instruments the farmers strummed on the rare occasion when they remembered to rest. The music would be magical. So tempting that no one would remember to do anything but rejoice. Surely that would be what life in faery would be like.
What else do they do, Jackie?
Asked a farmer with a creased face. Like the rest of the people in Hollow Groves, he was weather-worn and somber. Sitting in the dusty street, Jack tried to look past the fading wooden buildings and cheerless faces. What would please them? What will make them stay a little longer to listen?
Well, they have feasts the like of which we've never known. Long tables covered in silver trays, piled so high with sweets that it takes a full day to even see them all.
He paused and sighed, picturing it in his mind, layers of white icing-covered cakes and creamy puddings.
They're so happy that they laugh as they twirl round the table. Sometimes they don't even stop dancing to eat. They just reach out a hand as they swing past the table.
Many of them listened, held rapt as they often were when he spun tales. But some of the townsfolk finished their meals and left, returning to their fields and stores. They didn't say anything, just left. Jack felt like his words lost their magic bit by bit as people turned away. He knew it was silly, that magic wasn't real, but he tried.
Keep talking, maybe a few will linger.
And the clothes they wear. He shook his head and sighed longingly. Coats and gowns of spider silk with dew still clinging to it, just enough that it glitters when they twirl by the giant fires that they tend all through the day and night. It's glorious to see, but it's never the same twice. In fact, they can only wear their coats and gowns one time. You see, they dance so feverishly that after just the one night of dancing, the cloth is too tattered to be used for anything but rags. Jack wasn't sure where to go next, but it didn't matter. No matter where he wandered with his stories, it wasn't enough. Before he could even try to add another line to the tale, the last of the townsfolk wandered away. And Jack was left alone. Again. As Jack spun his fanciful tale, Ivy stayed in the shadows, listening. She could almost hear the revelry in Jack's story, and she swayed as if the rhythm had crept inside her skin. Even after his voice had faded and he sat silently, she could still imagine the music, the laughter. She wished his words were true, but her home hadn't been so lovely in her whole life. Faery was sick, withering with disease and sadness, just like the queen.
Ivy!
Jonquil gripped a handful of hair as Ivy started to dance, and the wee Elil was getting tangled in Ivy's long tumble of red hair. The fairy girl said,
"Give a bit of warning."
"Sorry." Ivy edged forward to see which way Jack went. When the people started leaving, Jack became stiller and quieter. Ivy ducked behind an old barrel, careful not to touch the metal ring that wrapped around it. One could never be sure with mortal-made things. A foolish brush against the wrong stuff, and she'd have an ugly burn to explain. Proof she'd been where she shouldn't. Reason for a lecture. Fields and woods weren't littered with iron the way villages were. Carefully, she rested her cheek on the wood and waited.
"What are you doing?"
Jonquil clutched Ivy's earlobe, her fingers curling around the edge, tickling it terribly.
"Shh."
Ivy reached up and rubbed her ear, pushing her friend further from it. In front of her, Jack yanked his cap off his head and shoved his curls back, even though he had no pesky Elilon tickling his ear. Ivy waited to see if he would go towards the lake or back to the Parson's house. If he went to the Parson's, Ivy would have no more chance to watch him today.
That man's house was riddled with iron.
But Jack grabbed his bag off the ground and slumped toward the lake. Ivy had listened as Jack told his tales to the creatures at the lakeside. They weren't real, but they were a lot prettier than what was real. When he spun stories, Ivy could forget crimson rivers and bone-dry lakes. Jack never spoke of Rowan children struggling to move over earth so foul it began boiling, oozing thick yellow slime. Instead, Jack Mary spoke of the world she wished her home could be, a world where the folk were happy and laughing. With a nervous catch to her voice, she told Jonquil,
"Go on, I'll be along soon."
Then she headed to the lake. After she'd been sent away by Ivy, Jonquil paused in the shadow of a dappled tree. She looked around to make sure that she wasn't watched, and then she ducked into a door that not even Ivy knew existed.
"Waited for you days now,"
the scorpion wife clacked her pinchers.
"Do you think it's so easy then to sneak away to meet you?"
She scuttled further into the burrow where she had been pretending to nest. Bits of something stringy and red squished under her many feet. Trying not to shudder, Jonquil followed her. For an Elilon to go into such a place? Best not to think on it.
"I'm here."
Jonquil tucked her hands into her pockets, fingering the poison pouches she kept there. It'd be a battle to get them into the scorpion wife's maw, but if it came down to that or joining the remains on the floor, she'd have little choice.
"Ivy's near ready to do something. Tell them."
The scorpion wife grinned, flashing the fang-like chelicerae on either side of her mouth.
"If the young one acts, we will wait. I cautioned against it. I wanted to act. Assassination is so satisfying."
She closed her eyes for a moment, savoring some image that Jonquil was happy not to share.
"But the others, they have no vision."
The scorpion wife waved a pincher like she was swatting a bog fly.
Ivy's growing impatient too, Jonquil said. She knows the folk talk of revolt. She may not support the queen, but she doesn't want her mother to be dead.
Jonquil loosened her grip on the poison in her pocket, but she kept it in the palm of her hand. Scorpion wives weren't the best at controlling their impulses.
Tell the others to wait just a while longer. And if I don't like your plan?
The scorpion wife scuttled closer again, crowding Jonquil.
If no one ever knew you were here, little winged thing, not much bigger than a fly.
Jonquil didn't have sharp edges like the creature in front of her, but the poison in her hand would incapacitate even the healthiest of the creatures. She squeezed a pouch so it puddled in her palm, then she pulled both hands out of her pockets and held them open before her. The slick green ooze shimmered in the low light. In the other, an unbroken pouch sat like a promise.
Loose poison in the eye, pouch in her mouth. I can do it.
The scorpion wife scuttled back 3 steps.
We will wait. Not forever.
Jonquil backed toward the entrance to the burrow, hands still outstretched. As Jonquil flew towards them, Daisy plummeted from the branches of the white willow and hovered beside her sister.
Jonquil, did you hear me? You're late. And why didn't you bring Ivy?
Jonquil scooped up a beetle and cradled it.
She'll be here.
Daisy zipped back up into the branches to the bird's nest where their sister Clematis had been napping.
You know where she was going, don't you?
Daisy said.
No, but I can guess.
Clematis grinned like a half-mad cockatrice.
Ivy's gone off to the same place as always, to stare at her mortal.
The nest shifted as Daisy flopped down. It was sheer foolishness to believe Ivy's status would keep her safe from the queen's madness.
One day the queen won't forgive her. One day Princess Ada will convince the queen that Ivy's a threat. And then what?
Her sisters had no answers. They never did. Ivy was their best hope for the future, but she was too young to think about crowns and revolutions. Jack strolled down the road out of town, past the houses and porches where townsfolk murmured amongst themselves.
Boy needs to be sent away. He has fey blood.
An elderly man shook his finger at the people around him.
No good comes of the wild ones.
They nodded, watching Jack warily. Though they were kind enough, they still didn't accept him at their hearths. They never had. He was fine for a story, a scrap or two when they had plenty. But no one trusted Jack Merry. Normal boys don't show up out of storms. In solemn tones, they'd repeat the story of his mysterious arrival. They'd swear the basket on the parson's doorstep was as dry as tinder, despite the terrible storm that night. They'd claim that the long-since-lost blanket wrapped around him that night was as delicate as if it were woven of moonlight. In the telling, they'd convinced themselves that Jack was something other. Jack believed none of it. He was as human as they were. He was ordinary in every way except for being an orphan. They made him extraordinary in their whispers and fears, and the result was that Jack was lonely. And all he wanted in the world was to have a family or friends. Widow Stonewell lifted a weathered hand as he strolled by her. She, at least, was kind to him.
Give my regards to the good folk, Jackie.
Sure, he'd dreamt it was true, that he was one of them. He hoped, begged, prayed even. Now he just considered it a good excuse to spin the stories he liked to imagine. If they were going to treat him that way, why not pretend to be what they all thought he was?
I will.
Jack tipped his cap to her. Then he continued towards the shore of the lake. At the lake, Jack leaned against an oak tree and thought of tales to tell the townsfolk. When winter snows lay heavy on the fields, they'd stop longer than those few moments at midday. They'd invite him to sit near the tavern fire. Then he was almost a part of the town. Almost. He stared at the sky, imagining what it'd be like to belong, not to be kept at a distance. The girls would giggle and look away. The townsfolk would wink and nod. He'd have a place, and he'd have a future. A barefoot girl, clad in dark green breeches and a long-sleeved tunic, stepped out of the woods.
"Shall I sit with you?"
Without waiting, she sat down beside him and stared out over the water. Though her clothes were cut of a cloth he'd not seen on even the wealthiest families, she sat on the ground as if her clothes were as ragged as his.
"You want to sit with me?"
Jack stared at her. She had dark eyes, like a night without stars, and those dark eyes were assessing him as if he were something peculiar. Not as the townsfolk did, but as if peculiarity was a wonderful thing. The girl buried her toes in the soft soil.
"I'm Ivy."
"Do you know who I am?"
He tried to sound teasing, but he felt the strangest urge to run. Mad as it seemed, he could almost swear he'd seen a deer with those same eyes watching him from the edge of the trees.
"Girls are not sometimes deer, not even in the stories he made up."
"Oh, indeed, I do know."
She nodded rapidly, sending red hair away from her face, revealing features too delicate to be real. Her ink-black eyes widened just slightly. He wondered if the girl beside him was somehow kin to the woodland creatures that gathered at the lake. He couldn't decide if she seemed more like the deer or the wolves he'd seen in the forests. Whatever she wasn't someone he'd ever seen in the village. She held his gaze as she pronounced,
"You are Jack Mary, the so-called son of the fairy folk."
Jack swallowed hard, watching her.
"She's merely a girl, an odd girl, but a girl nonetheless."
He swallowed hard several times and tried to calm himself. She leaned so close that her breath was warm on his cheek.
"Oh, Jack Mary, are you quite all right?"
Jack could hear a faint ringing of bells, delicate things that in his mind were made of sea glass. Perhaps he'd been too long in the sun, imagining strange girls as forest animals, hearing bells. Before long, he'd be muttering fairy legends like the Good Widow.
"I'm fine," he insisted. "I'm completely fine."
He leaned back against the oak tree and tucked his hands behind his head to hide their trembling. His voice was barely shaking when he asked,
"So, aren't you afraid the fae folk will spirit you off to a fairy hill if they come to visit me?"
She laughed, an eerie sound, like a loon's song on a dark night, and the resounding ring of glass bells grew briefly deafening. Then she winked and began pulling items from her satchel.
"Tell me a story, fairy boy."
Ivy watched Jack wrestle with the urge to run from her. He clenched his jaw. He looked around. He swallowed loudly. Then, settling his gaze on the lake, he reached up and tugged that horrible cap off his head. He squirmed, but he hadn't run yet. She prompted,
"If we were to go to your fairy hill..."
She began braiding a length of rope together with a flowering vine. If he couldn't get past the natural fear mortals seemed to feel around the folk, well, it was all for naught. She'd hoped that all her visits in the guise of deer would help him learn to resist that fear. But here he was, looking like he was a heartbeat from flight. It was disappointing, but she wasn't going to give up on him yet. He was special. She knew it.
From the shadows, she'd listened to his tales and remembered the old legends. A mortal who'd tell a tale that became. Jack Marr could do that, she was sure. He could change things. He could help her save her home. Jack began.
Well, inside the hill, the feasts last longer than a human's life, and the tables are always set with silver goblets that gleam like they're filled with moonlight.
He paused, a small smile on his lips. And Ivy knew he could see the things he'd spoken, see them in his mind as truly as if they'd floated to the surface of the lake in front of them. She whispered, "Would you go to the fairy realm, Jack Marr?"
Jack laughed, quick and fleeting. "Perhaps I have. Perhaps it's why I know these stories."
"You haven't. We both know that. But suppose you could. Would you go there? Really and truly?" She paused, twisting the intricate knots in her rope. Her fingers were clumsy with excitement and nervousness. It was making the process take far longer than it usually did.
"If you were invited, what would you say then?"
Jack lifted one eyebrow. But a mortal can't stay there. And they say that once a person goes inside a fairy hill, he'll waste away from wanting once he returns to this world.
Ivy thought of the changes in the realm, trees rotting and waters thick with strange poisons. She shook her head. "They're wrong." Then she lifted the vine and whistled, long and piercing. Suddenly the waters shivered. In front of them, forming as if from the water of the lake itself, was a great white horse with eyes as green as the moss in the deepest part of the forest and a neck as thick as ancient trees. It drew a deep breath, sides quivering. Jack blinked. Water didn't solidify into horses. That was simply not how anything worked. But it stood there, larger than any animal he'd ever seen. Light rippled on its skin, just as it did on the lake's surface. The magical creature in front of him was both horse and water all at the same time. Ivy hopped up from the ground and walked calmly toward the creature. She stood ankle deep in the water, held out her hand, palm up, and murmured, "Shh, now." The beast huffed a great breath, filling the air with the sweet scent of lilacs, as if objecting. Then it made a noise that might have been a word, but was probably a nicker. Finally, it lowered its head. Murmuring strange words, Ivy rubbed her cheek against the animal's face, and then she looped the braided vine about his neck. It stood perfectly still. The only movement was the steady, deep breaths it drew, but the sense of barely restrained movement was almost tangible, as if the smallest step would start an unstoppable charge. And Jack was sure that whatever was in its path would be trampled. Ivy swung herself astride the water horse. Holding the end of her vine in one hand, she extended the other hand towards him. As she did, he could see misty shapes of wings unfolding on her back, like the fog in the morning was hovering behind her back. They weren't solid wings, and he wasn't so sure they were ever present. But if he had to swear to the parson, Jack was certain he could say he met a fairy at the edge of the lake.
"So what say you, Jack Marr? Will you join me?" Ivy asked.
"You're real."
He let out a long breath before whispering,
"It's all real? Fairies?"
"Oh, indeed, Jack, we are quite real."
Ivy held up her hand and added, "But there's strife aplenty where I go, and not all fey things are kind." Her eerie black irises widened so far that if he'd had any doubt that she was something other, it would have fled in that instant.
"Will you trade vows, Jack Marr? Let me take you into the fairy realm,
Stay with me for 3 days, and I promise you my full truth on whatever you ask of me by the third eve.
A shiver ran through him as she spoke, but Jack gripped his tattered sack and looked up at her. Strife aplenty, she said. He looked around at the woods, the lake, the world he knew. Then he turned his gaze to her, a fairy on a strange water steed inviting him into a new world. Behind her back, the air moved as if great green leaves stretched open and closed. I'd be a fool to turn down such a chance.
I will, he promised.
Your vow, then?
Yes, I vow it. 3 days, he swore.
Ivy took his hand and, with surprising strength, pulled him up behind her. There were no wings blocking his view, but he felt as if they'd brushed against him. Leafy, feathery shapes slid over his cheek as he settled on the water-made horse. Briefly, Jack wondered what he'd done when the chiming of glass bells came again, this time like the crash of falling ice all around them.
It didn't seem like a good omen. Whatever it was, though, Jack was only there for 3 days. How much could go wrong in only 3 days?
Chapter 2, in which Jack sees the forest in an altogether new way. As the horse sped past fields into the edge of the wood, Jack clung to Ivy. Creatures didn't move this fast. They didn't run so quickly that their hooves forgot to touch the ground. Jack couldn't decide if he was excited or about to throw up. He had tried gazing at the horse's massive neck, but too soon found his vision blurring. The horse was not white at all, but jumbled hues like the inside of an abalone shell. Finally, after what was either hours or a second, Ivy tugged the vine looped lightly around the horse's neck, stopping them as suddenly as they'd started. Glaring into the shadowed branches above them, Ivy asked, "Why are you still waiting here? I said I'd be along." They were in a grassy clearing that Jack hadn't ever seen, and he'd explored a full 2 days' walk from the village. He peered around, seeing only brambles and close-cropped grass. He looked up. An empty bird's nest was the only thing in the tree.
"She speaks to birds?"
Ivy's voice dropped even lower. "I'm quite aware of what I'm doing. You needn't be involved."
Birds he couldn't see or hear.
Craning his neck, Jack stared into the branches of a tree where Ivy seemed to be looking. Leaves, branches, maybe a bird's nest. Maybe someone is hidden behind the leaves. He squinted and saw
absolutely nothing. "Ivy, who are you talking to?"
"The Elalon." Ivy glanced into the branches again, put her hands on her hips, and frowned. "Meddlesome Elalon, actually. That's what they are. If they want to avoid the troubles to come, they ought to go home where it's safe." She pursed her lips. "If they had any sense whatsoever, they'd go home."
"Elalon?" Jack repeated, staring into the seemingly empty air.
"Tiny fairies, Jack." Ivy looked back at him.
"Where?" He spun around to try to see them. She snorted, a silly sound he wouldn't ever have thought a fairy could make, and said,
"Though they claim they're big enough to defend themselves against clumsy mortals, stop thrashing about so."
"Defend themselves? I'm no threat to them."
Ivy stared back towards the trees where the Elalon apparently were. "Still and true, Daisy says they refuse to show themselves." Jack sat very still, peering at the tree, covering one eye, trying to look sideways out of an eye, blinking.
It was no good. He saw nothing but branches and an old nest. "If I stay still, can I see them?"
"You mean no threat to the Elalon, and they might do well to remember it, mightn't they?"
Ivy swung her satchel up from where she had fastened it on the long vine and rummaged around in it.
I suppose there's no reason not to give you the sight now.
She pulled a dirty clay pot out of her satchel and opened it. Inside was a milky substance that looked a bit like garden slugs. She dipped her fingers into the stuff.
Close your eyes and hold still. I don't want to get this all over your face.
Jack closed his eyes while she spread the gooey.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.